architect Meera Milan Ajit. She's currently working as a senior architect at L&T Construction, Buildings and Factories. She has worked for various commercial and institutional projects for the Engineering Design Research Center, ranging from shopping malls, IT parks to metro rails. She has attended many national conferences and seminars. She's also worked as a freelancer in Chennai for various projects.
Welcome to UGC Lecture Series Architecture. I will now be taking you through History of Architecture and Culture 1, that is AR6101. This particular lecture covers the second part of Unit 5, that is Classical Period Rome. In the previous lecture, you saw what are the socio-cultural and political influences that led to the classical Roman architecture. What are the temples and forums of Roman architecture? The example of the said temples and forums, and we saw the Pantheon Rome. Moving on, in this particular lecture, you will be seeing the basilicas, the thermae or great baths of Rome, the theatres and amphitheatres with the example of Colosseum Rome. So, understanding basilicas of the classical period of Rome differs from the said basilicas of the modern day early Christian architecture that you will be seeing in the coming semesters of your architecture education. So, in this particular basilica is a very different from that of the early Christian basilicas which you will be seeing now. So, these basilicas were erected as the halls of justice or as exchanges for merchants, comprises some of the finest buildings which were erected by the Romans, and it bears witness to importance of law and justice in their eyes. So, in the early Christian architecture, basilicas refer to the Christian prayer halls, whereas in the Roman architecture, the basilicas refer to the Roman halls of justice, or it's the area where law and justice were given the utmost importance. So, these buildings are also interesting as a link between the classic and Christian architecture. So, that became this formed the link of those. The usual plan was rectangle, whose length was 2 or 3 times the width. 2 or 4 rows of columns ran through the entire length, resulting in 3 or 5 aisles depending, and galleries were usually placed over this, exactly very similar to the plan of the basilicas of early Christian architecture. So, the entrance was at the side at one end and the tribunal at the other, or the raised dais, generally placed in the semicircular apse, which was sometimes partly cut off from the main body of the building by columns. So, this ranged around the apse was seals of the assessors, that were the center which was elevated above the rest, being occupied by the praetor or the questor. So, in front of the apse was the altar where the sacrifice was performed before commencing important business. That's what altar was for in the Roman basilicas, and the building was generally covered with a wooden roof, and the exterior seems to have been of small pretensions in comparison with the interiors. The major example that we'll be seeing today is the Trajan's Basilica. So, Trajan's Basilica, also known as the Alpian Basilica Rome, which is like a major part of the Roman historical architecture. This was constructed in AD 98 and it was constructed by Apollodorus of Damascus. He was the architect of the said building. It's a fine example of wooden roofed architecture. So, you can see in the background, this is the picture of the Trajan's Basilica. This is the cross section of the Trajan's Basilica. It's entered from Trajan's Forum and has a central nave 87 feet wide with double aisles, and each 23 feet 9 inches wide, and has an internal length excluding the apses of around 385 feet. See, as I said in my previous lecture, the forum is a public market space or a space which was surrounded by important government buildings or important buildings of the then Rome. So, this Trajan's Basilica was a part of this Trajan's Forum, and that's from where this entrance was from. So, and this was around 385 feet in internal length, excluding the apses. So, the total internal height was around 120 feet, and the columns on the ground story spreading the nave and aisles were of red granite from Sion with white marble and Corinthian capitals again. See, Corinthian capital in Rome kind of was considered advanced construction because of the intricacies of the capital of the said column. So, most of the important buildings in Rome exhibited the Corinthian columns as a demonstration of the advanced architecture, or the amount of detailing that they have given to the architecture is very well seen. So, at each end were semicircular apses, as I said, and it was reached by flights of steps, and it has a sacrificial altars in front of them, where sacrifices used to take place before a major decision was taken. And the galleries were there, it was formed over the side aisles and it was reached by steps, and as shown on the plan. This is the plan of the said Trajan's Basilica. This is where the entrance happens, it's entrance from the forum, and these are the steps, and this is the altar where the said sacrifices happens. There is another altar here, and this is the tribunal for judges and assessors. On either sides you had the tribunal for the judges and assessors where they sit, and this is where the Trajan's column is. This is the Trajan's column, you can see, and this is where this was there. And there are two libraries on either side, that is the galleries, and that was accessed by the steps, as you can see here. So, adjoining the basilica were the Greek and Latin libraries, and Trajan's famous column stood in the open court between them. This is the cross section of the Trajan's basilica, and this is how the interior would have looked back then. And this is the gallery space. Here is you have the apse, and where and this is the aisles. So, next major part of Roman architecture that we will be seeing is the Thermae, or the Great Public Baths of Rome. The Thermae, or the Great Public Baths of Rome, are quite characteristic of the Roman civilization, as the amphitheaters being probably derived from the Greek gymnasia. So, why this particular baths is important is because this kind of directly symbolifies the Roman interests in public gatherings or doing, you know, it's more of a, so Rome, as I said, was more of a social country where, you know, where people used to like spending time together, let it be from, so that's why they had from temples to the, you know, forums to the Thermae to the amphitheaters, everything was more like a public space there. So, the principal existing remains found at Rome and Pompeii in the ruined state. So, there is no baths that is existing as of now in the exact form that was before. So, almost every Roman baths that we see right now is all in ruined form. So, we kind of arrived on how it would have looked back then. So, the Thermae supplied the place of the modern daily papers for the dissemination of news and gossip, and also the, you know, also answered in a measure the purpose of the modern club and rendezvous of social life. So, it kind of acted like a place where people could come in, discuss whatever is happening in the society, whatever is happening around them, or whatever is happening in the news, and, you know, they could talk, they could gossip, they could, you know, it was like a rendezvous of social life that was happening in this particular area. It was a small charge of quadrants was sometimes made, but in later days they were, you know, opened free as bribe to the populace by emperors in such popularity. So, the general arrangement of this particular Thermae, or the Roman, Great Roman Baths, had three particular main parts. That one is the great central block, then there was a large open space, and three, the outer ring of the apartments. So, the great central block was planned for the baths proper. So, the process of bathing resembling the modern Turkish bath. This particular great central block had the tepidarium, that is the warm room for bathers rest in, and the calidarium, or the hot room, usually containing a warm water bath. Then there is laconium, or the sudatarium, that is the hottest room, which was usually circular or domed apartment, and the frigidarium, that is the cool room, which usually contains a cold swimming pool, piscina. So, these were the major part of this particular, you know, central block. So, that is, they had the warm room for bathers to rest in, they had the hot room for people to take bath in. And then there was a hottest room which had circular domed apartment and a cool room that had a swimming pool for people to bath in. So added were the apoditeria, that is rooms for undressing. There was rooms for oil, that is called the onctarium. Then there was the spectarium, that is a place for the games and games of ball. And then there were libraries, there were small theaters, and it kind of formed like a now modern clubs of the present day. So they were, even they had rooms to change, there were rooms to massage or applying oil, there were room to for warm baths, there were room for warm restings, and there were cold swimming pool, everything in the great central block. Moving on, there's a large open space, as I said, and this particular place surrounded the central block and was frequently laid out as a stadium. So this had great seat for spectators, and this was used for various athletic exercises such as wrestling, races, boxing. So athletics, as I said, in Rome was very, very prominent. So this particular spaces was usually used for the said athletic exercises, and they were planted with trees and ornamented with statues and everything. And then there was the outer ring of apartment. And this consisted of lecture rooms for the hearing of discourses, open colonnades, x-ray or recesses for the philanthropers, poets and statesmen, and other necessary apartments in this third area. So, major example of the Thermae is the Thermae of Caracalla in Rome that we'll be seeing right now. This was constructed between AD 212 to 235. And it accommodates 1,600 bathers and are the most important of all the remains and gives a splendid idea of their sites and magnificence. So the entire site, including the garden, was raised on an artificial platform which is 20 feet high. So that's kind of, even the landscape or the garden was in a raised platform that showed how intricate and modern the architecture of the then Roman period was, and how much new techniques were used in the Roman time. So the entire site, as I said, was in an artificial platform which is 20 feet high and measured around 1,150 feet each way, which did not include the segmental projections on three of the sites. So under this platform were communicating corridors leading to various parts of the establishment, vaulted chambers, used stores, the hypocaust and the furnaces for the heating of water, hot air duct, etc. That under this. So this is how the Thermae of Caracalla that in Rome would have looked back then. You can see the platform in which it's raised in. So along the road front was a colonnade having behind. This is the colonnade which we are talking about. So around the front, road front was a colonnade having behind it a row of small chambers in two stories. The lower on the street level were used as the shops, and the upper on the platform level for flywheel slipper baths. So this is the said two levels facing the road, and this had shops in this level, and over that they had private spaces for baths. So that showed how much the market culture was existing in Rome even back then, and how much people used to spend time outside in the social circle, and they had their own social circle and their own markets places in the back then in Rome. So the entrance to the establishment was in the center of the northeastern facade, and it led to a large open enclosure led out in the for the wrestling and other games, as I said, the athletic games, around which in the segment processions and elsewhere were grouped various halls of dramatic representation and lectures. Those were the apartments, as I said before. So the central building was entirely for bathing, which measured around 750 feet by 380 feet and therefore covered an area of 285,000 square feet. So this is the central area, and this is a said court around it. There were only four doorways, and they were formed on the northeastern side and was exposed to cold winds. But large columned openings were given, giving access to the gardens, and that were the feature of the southwestern facade that was like very evident. So internally, the trepidarium formed the principal hall, around which the subsidiary apartments were grouped that consisted the controlling feature of the plan to which the other apartments were subordinated. So it was 170 feet by 82 feet, and it was roofed with an immense semicircular intersecting concrete vault which is 108 feet above the floor, and it formed three compartments, and it supported on eight portions of entablature resting on granite columns. So this is the restored plan of the Terme of Caracalla, Rome, and this is how the plan would have looked back then. So this is the gymnasium, as I said before, on either sides. Then there is the natatio or the swimming pool. This is the hot bath, that is Caldarium, that's the hot bath which happens here. And this is the cold swimming pool, that is a Frigidarium. And this is the warm bath area, that is a Tepidarium, that happened, that was there. So there was the hot bath, there was the warm bath, there was a cold bath, and then there was a swimming pool for the public bathing. And then there was a gymnasium on either side that was considered to be a take from the Greek architecture. And this is the remains of the Terme of Caracalla right now, and this is how it looks right now. Moving on to the next important feature of Roman architecture, that is the theatres and amphitheatres. In the previous chapter, we saw the theatres of Greece and how important theatres was back in there in Greece. And the Greek theatre and Roman theatre was very, very similar in nature. The design of the Greek theatres was adapted to suit the Roman requirements, and that's how the Roman theatres function or the look came in. The auditorium was a semicircular in nature and consisted of tiers of seats, one above the other, with side passages and staircases communicating with the external porticos of each story. At the ground level separating the auditorium of sloping seats from the stage was a semicircular area which was occupied by the senators. The stage, thus becoming important, was raised considerably, and it was treated with great richness and became connected more completely with the auditorium. So stage became the most, definitely was the most major part of the set design. So that was maximum decorated and detailed out at that time. So the theatres were constructed on the slope of a hill usually, and if tire upon tire of connecting corridors were made, and people could run in there if in case of sudden showers. So that was an addition to the Greek architecture that you can see in the Roman theatre architecture. The major example of the theatre that we would be seeing is the Theatre of Orange in southern France. This particular theatre held 7,000 spectators and is an example where the auditorium is constructed and not hollowed out of a side of a hill. See, in Greece, theatres were usually and only made out of the side of the hills and then carved out of that and perform. You know, they use a select site at the side of the hills and carve out their theatres. In Rome, that was the usual practice, but also there were theatres that were constructed and not hollowed out of the side of the hill. And this particular theatre at Orange in the southern France is an example. In diameter, it is 340 feet between the enclosing walls, and staircases for access to the various levels were placed on either side of the stage, which is 203 feet wide by 45 feet deep and enclosed by return walls of right angles to the back wall. The great wall at the back of the stage was 314 feet long and 116 feet high and is ornamented by blind arcading. So this is how the theater look right now, and this is the said, as I said, this is not a hilly site, so this was a constructed theater, not a carved out theater. And the amphitheatres, again, moving on to the amphitheatres, the amphitheatres are characteristic Romanistic buildings, and this is basically Roman in nature. It was found as a very important settlement, and in addition to their normal purposes, it was used for naval exhibitions. The water drains for flooding the arena still exist in many examples. So the modern Spanish bull rings to some degree give an idea of the arrangement of the uses of Roman amphitheatres. And these are good exponents of the character and the life of the Romans. As I said, this directly implies the public life of the Roman, socialized life of the Romans back then. So they had greater love for martial combats, which were considered to be a good training for nation of warriors than the tame of the mimicry of stage. So the major example of this said amphitheater we'll be seeing right now is the Flavian Amphitheater, better known as the Colosseum in Rome. So it was commenced by Vespasian in AD 70 and was completed by Domitian in AD 82. Domitian completed almost the whole building except the upper story. The model of the buildings, the model in the Crystal Palace gives us a good idea of the general distribution of its parts. In plan is a type of all the examples consisting of vast eclipse of 620 feet by 513 feet, and it externally it has 80 openings on each story. Those on the ground floor forming the entrances by means of which various tiers of seats were reached. And the arena is proper oval in shape, which is 287 feet surrounded by a wall which is 15 feet high. The seats are made of solid stone and it rises up from the arena, having underneath them the corridors and staircases. So this is the elevation, the present condition of the Flavian Amphitheater, that is the Colosseum in Rome. Presently it looks like this. So, there were dens of wild beasts that were immediately under the lowest tiers of seats and consequently opened into the arena as at Verona. So, that actually that this kind of game, the gladiator game, was very much relevant and prominent in Rome back then. So, the wild beasts were kind of stored beneath the seats. So, the auditorium has four rings of seats. The two of the lower forms the grand tiers. The third separated from the second by a wall, and the top range under the peristyle forms the later addition. So, the access to the various seats from the 80 entrances by means of staircases placed between them with the radiating walls and the corridors are placed by the intervals. So, you can see this is the plan of the said Colosseum, and this is the gladiators entrance, and these are the set seats of the particular Colosseum that I was talking about. So, quarter of the plan had a Corinthian range in the second floor, other quarter had a Tuscan range in the ground floor, and the other quarter had Ionic range in the first floor. That the use of the Corinthian, Ionic and Tuscan columns in this particular construction by itself, it forms a major part of the architecture of this particular building. We will learn what is the Tuscan column in the coming lecture. So, the masonry was laid out without the mortar, and the construction is so strong and solid, and the system is one of the concrete walls resting on the walls on the same material, 2 feet 3 inches thick and faced with a travertine stone which is 4 feet thick, and it has an internal lining of 9 inches of brickwork which makes 7 feet in total thickness. The supports have been calculated 1/6 of the total area. So, the external facade is divided into 4 stories. The 3 lower ones have their walls pierced with arches and are ornamented with half columns with Tuscan, Ionic and Corinthian orders, as I said before, and the 2 later is on the pedestals. So, the upper story has Corinthian plasters, and the height of the top order is 157 feet. Between the plasters and the cobbles used to support the mass and the velarium. This is the interior of the said amphitheater. This is how it looks. This is the major cross section of the said place. So, there is square windows and bronze shields here. The top 2 sires are used to seat women, plebs, slaves, and the seating is made of wood. Then lower 2 tiers of seating are for upper class people, that is emperor, vestal, magistrates, senators, patricians. An emperor has his own podium to sit on. This is the side access to the arena, this particular door that you see here, and this is the trap door with the lift in order to bring out the animals, wild animals that is kept inside. This is a fighting arena with the wooden floor which is covered in sand, and this is the dungeon for the animals in this area, and this is from there they come out. The different construction materials are used, and the lightest is used at the top, and arches and tunnels which leads and stairs that leads to the vomiteria and out of the seats is given here. So, you can see the steps that leads up like this. And this is constructed on a drained lake. This particular place is constructed on a drained lake site. And there are 3 floors of arches and columns in Doric, Ionic and Corinthian side. As I said before, these are the said 3 floors. Moving on to the summary of the lecture. In this particular lecture, we saw the early basilicas of Rome and their examples. We saw the architecture and relevance of the Thermae of the Great Roman Bath, and is discussed with examples. We saw the theatres and amphitheatres and their planning and how they differed from the Greek theatres and how much they were similar to the Greek theatres. Both were discussed and weighed. And the architecture of the Colosseum has been discussed in detail and understood. Moving on to the question, we saw explain the architecture of the basilicas of classical Rome with examples. What are the Thermae? Explain with example. Explain the architecture of Roman theatre with an example. Elaborate the architecture of the Flavian Amphitheatre, Rome. Thank you.